movement in the 60s. So I strongly support ENDA because it's important that we protect everyone.
My name is Fred Karger. I'm the founder and president of Rights Equal Rights. I just wrapped up a campaign recently. I was the first openly gay candidate to ever run for president of the United States of a major political party. And I was very honored to run as a Republican to shake things up within my own party. The Republican Party that I've been a part of and grew up with, starting in the 60s when I first got involved in politics, and then in the 70s and 80s, and through now, was very, very different. It had a much more moderate, centrist bent. The candidates, the politicians, the elected officials were much more in the center. They were actually leaders in civil rights. People like Nelson Rockefeller, George Romney, Mitt Romney's family, father, marched with black leaders in the civil rights marches in the 60s. So this is the kind of Republican Party I was hoping to bring back. It's moved so far to the right, thanks to actually some Dixiecrat Democrats like Strom Thurmond and Jesse Helms from North and South Carolina that came into the party in the 60s and 70s that have wrecked it. So I thought a voice of moderation, an openly gay candidate speaking about rights and freedom for everyone would be a welcome addition to the debate in this last presidential cycle. I did a lot of firsts in the campaign. I was the first to start campaigning. I was the first to file. I was first to file an exploratory committee, the first to hire staff, do commercials. I then got a lot of attention, and I got up in the polls. I was ahead of Santorum. I was ahead of Gingrich in one poll. And the news media that runs the 20 debates that were aired during this last presidential cycle generally use the criteria of 1 or 2% in national polls. Well, just about a year ago, in August of 2011, Fox News had its second debate in Ames, Iowa, in conjunction with a straw poll. I qualified for that because I'd been at over 1% in 6 national polls, and that was their criteria, was in 5. Well, they didn't invite me. So I sent a letter to Rupert Murdoch and Roger Ailes, who's president of the network, extending the fact that I accept the debate, and where should I report? Well, I didn't hear back personally, but a reporter with the Des Moines Register did and said that, oh, those polls don't count. Well, they changed the rules, and so I filed a complaint against Rupert Murdoch and Roger Ailes and the Fox News company with the Federal Election Commission, which I didn't do lightly. It's a very serious claim to make. They spent 18 months investigating it. They spent about 9 months investigating my complaint, the FEC did, and they eventually ruled that I had no claim, but they did agree that the rules were changed and said that that was allowed. Well, that is not the rule. So I understand there are a lot of people. There were 12 of us running for president then, and 4 of us were left out. One was a sitting congressman, 2 were former governors, so I was in pretty good company. But by not getting in that debate last August, I never was able to get the momentum to get up in the polls to be in other debates. When Fox News refused to allow me in that August debate in Ames, Iowa, I was very hurt. I was angry because I had qualified. The first debate they did in South Carolina, Greenville, where I went in May of that year, I didn't qualify, but I still showed up. I did the spin room, and that was very different because they had set the criteria, which is 1% in 5 national polls. Well, I'd only been in 1 national poll at that time, and it had been a Fox News poll of all things, where I did score 1%. And so I had a lot of bumps in the road in my 2.5-year campaign for president. I was very hurt by not necessarily the Republican Party. I was welcomed from Reince Priebus, the chairman who ran on an anti-gay marriage platform about 2 months after he was elected. In 2011, I met with him and the vice chair, Sharon Day, and their chief of staff, Jeff Larson. Could not have been nicer, afforded me all the opportunities of the RNC, including the voter list, research, all the meetings, and they fulfilled all of those promises. I was really hurt by a lot of these third-party groups, like the National Organization for Marriage, the Family Research Council. These are the groups that have an inordinate amount of clout within the Republican Party because they give a lot of money, and they are bullies. And those are the groups that really hurt me. Steve Scheffler, who was coincidentally the Republican National Committeeman from Iowa and head of the Faith and Freedom Coalition, which is Ralph Reed's group, the old Christian Coalition. They've got a new name. And they would not allow me in a presidential forum in Iowa. And he had said that any presidential candidate who showed the slightest interest in running would be invited. The Wall Street Journal, well, I filed a FEC complaint against him. Those were my two. That is still under investigation. I didn't think the FEC would go after Fox just because it's just too difficult to do a major network. But certainly this Steve Scheffler and the Faith and Freedom Coalition is ripe. They were absolutely blatant. We even filed a supplemental complaint because at the forum where all the other candidates were invited and attended, he said things to say that all candidates were welcome. So he really stuck his foot in his mouth as usual. I was also hurt by a lot of the LGBT organizations, the Victory Fund. I've been a longtime supporter of theirs. I had a fundraiser at my house about 6 or 7 years ago for them. I think what they do is spectacular, but I was shunned by them. I finally, after a lot of persistence, was asked to submit my short form application, and then after that, my long form application. I never even heard back from them. I spent 2 weeks working on my 30-page application for them, and as the first openly gay presidential candidate in history, my chances of winning, of course, were very slim. But it would have made a big difference to have the Victory Fund on my side. And so, you know, this is something that history will record. Other organizations were there for me. Log Cabin was great. Go Proud came around. A lot of organizations saw the value of what I was doing in my 2.5-year run for president. Since I was about 14, I volunteered on my first campaign. That was for Nelson Rockefeller running for president. And I've never stopped. I worked in my home state of Illinois where I grew up with Charles Percy, who was a good moderate Republican. 64 for his governor's race, 66 for the Senate race, which was successful. 72, I worked full-time on that right after college. I then came to California and started working with a political consulting firm founded by Bill Roberts, who ran Reagan's first two campaigns for governor. So I learned from the best. And we did nonstop work for Republican candidates, for the party, for the, you name it. I worked on 9 presidential campaigns, all for Republicans. But I become disenchanted with the Republican Party because of the takeover by the far right, the influence of these third party outside groups. That I decided to step up to the plate for the first time in my life and run for President of the United States. I'd never run for office before. But I think others in the LGBT community need to come forward, particularly within the Republican Party. The Democratic Party, we have pretty well covered, so I think it's important that anyone who's LGBT stay in the Republican Party and fight from within. And it's tough. We get a lot of pressure. I live in Southern California. I get asked all the time, how can you be a Republican? Well, because the Republican Party of 1854 put in its platform then an anti-slavery statement. That was very controversial then. Of course, Abraham Lincoln, our first Republican president, ended slavery and brought this country together. And 100 years later, Theodore Roosevelt, Republican president, hired the first African Americans that had ever been hired in the federal government, only to be fired by the Democrat successor, Woodrow Wilson. So we have a long history of inclusion, of civil rights leadership going all the way to the 60s, 70s, 80s, and many of us that are fighting now in the millennium. So I think we need to stand tough and fight. We need both parties. Don't forget, the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell would not have happened without the courage of Senator Susan Collins of Maine and Senator Joe Lieberman. The president had given up at that point. And also 8 Republicans in the United States Senate who courageously stood up to their leadership to vote to repeal Don't Ask, Don't Tell. 15 in the House. Same thing. And then in New York State, 4 Republican state senators stood up to the National Organization for Marriage, to the Cardinal and everyone else, and they voted to allow marriage in New York State. We wouldn't have had that margin of victory without them. So we need to realize there's a two-party system, and we need to back the Republican Party. I just think that the Republican Party needs to be at the table. They're coming around. We're getting a lot of people, starting with Dick Cheney and others who happen to have gay or lesbian family members. We've got Paul Singer now, who is very close to Mitt Romney, one of the billionaire successes on Wall Street, who has put up millions of dollars to pass these marriage in these states and fight the marriage bans and others. And so things are looking brighter for the Republican Party, and we need to encourage people and younger people, and we've got some great role models out there, but it needs to be a two-party fight. I cannot emphasize that enough. If every LGBT person goes to the Democratic Party, we'll be taken for granted, and they won't need to fight for us. If there's a battle for the money and the votes, That is good, but we need to cover both bases, and I pledge to do whatever I can, as long as I'm around, to change the Republican Party, bring it back to its roots. I like to call it the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, because it's so clear how any member of the House of Representatives or the Senate could oppose non-discrimination employment is beyond me. If I were running the show and fighting for that, I would be running ads in the districts of these very ardent opponents of equality, and particularly on the committee level, and just ripping them apart. This is a constitutional issue. This is non-discrimination. All men and women are created equal. It shouldn't even be up for discussion. The fact that in 39 states there's still discrimination against LGBT members. We're making a few breakthroughs. Utah, for example, with a lot of pressure on the Mormon Church, that was their first step, and they did that in Salt Lake City. It's happening in cities. It's happening in West Virginia. They're trying for that right now. On a call with a Senate leader there. So there is hope. We're trying to get into the very red South and make this happen, because then once it happens in enough states, we think the federal government will do it. I was hoping to be President of the United States. That was going to be one of my very first acts, was an executive order ending any discrimination with any federal contractor out there. I was disappointed President Obama didn't sign that. I think it helped him, though, go and come out in support of full marriage equality, because he had to say no to that. But we need a president who will stand up, who will do the right thing, and not worry about any criticism. And certainly there is no place in this country for any discrimination, employment or housing, or against any human being in this nation. I think we need to continue to go after the opponents of equality. The only way we're gonna stop these elections from being losses for us is to tell the other side of this. We've got a situation in Maine now where they continue to just talk about loving couples. Well, we've done that in 33 states. We've lost 33 times. They're doing a lot of great things. I think it's wonderful, but they are for some reason reticent to go after the National Organization for Marriage, who was under investigation in two states, who's been severely hurt by secret documents that came out as a result of the investigation in Maine. You have a situation there where the Catholic Church spokesperson during the last campaign has said they lied. Mark Nutty has admitted to lying and that they were untruthful. That should be a big part of this campaign. This is the National Organization for Marriage, Maggie Gallagher, Brian Brown, funding all four of these November elections. And we're sitting on the sidelines ignoring them as if they don't exist. It's the only campaign, I think, in the history of the United States where we haven't talked about the opponents. And for some reason, and I think it's because these are done by committee and we're too nice, we've got to tell the other side of the story. These are evil, devious people that have gotten away with it, and hopefully will not for long when these investigations come to fruition in California and Maine. I'm hoping for a federal investigation. I've been screaming for 4 years for that. They don't file their taxes. A good example of what the other side has been doing, when the HRC released some very interesting documents that showed that there were about $445,000 of unreported money from the National Organization for Marriage, including $10,000 from Mitt Romney, into the Prop 8 campaign. The very next day, they, of course, threatened to sue HRC, pulled it off its website, and Orrin Hatch, the head of the Senate Finance Committee, ordered a Senate investigation of the HRC. I was trying to get the Barney Frank in the House to do that for years against the National Organization for Marriage. So we don't fight back. We're timid. There's no excuse for timidity. We've gotten Don't Ask, Don't Tell repealed because of courage and guts and chaining themselves to the White House fence, and that's what we need. And I'm not advocating civil disobedience, but we can go through the courts, we can go through the press, we can go through all kinds of activities to shed light on our opponents, who are awful, terrible people out to do nothing but destroy lives. So that is a message that I will continue to take with me. And then once we have the money advantage and the public support advantage, the days of prejudice and non-equality will be very limited.